فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، سورة عبسة. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. عبس وتولى أن جاءه الأعمى وما يدريك لعله يزكى أو يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى، أما من استغنى فأنت له تصدى وما عليك ألا يزكى، وأما من جاءك يسعى وهو يخشى فأنت عنه تلهى، كلا إنها تذكرة فمن شاء ذكره في صحف مكرمة مرفوعة مطهرة بأيدي سفرة كرام بررة. قتل الإنسان ما أكفره، من أي شيء خلقه، من نطفة خلقه فقدره، ثم السبيل يسره، ثم أماته فأقبره، ثم إذا شاء أنشره، كلا لما يقض ما أمره. فلينظر الإنسان إلى طعامه أنا صببنا الماء صبا، ثم شققنا الأرض شقا، فأنبتنا فيها حبا وعنبا وقضبا وزيتونا ونخلا وحدائق غلبا وفاكهة وأبا متاعا لكم ولأنعامكم. فإذا جاءت الصاخة يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه وصاحبته وبنيه، لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه، وجوه يومئذ مسفرة ضاحكة مستبشرة، ووجوه يومئذ عليها غبرة ترهقها قترة، أولئك هم الكفرة الفجرة. سورة عبسة. This surah, سورة عبسة, it came down in the affairs of Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum, this noble companion. This surah, it came down regarding the affairs of the noble companion Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum. Aisha said, the wife of the Prophet, she said, أَتَى إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ ابْنُ أُمِّ مَكْتُومِ. He came to the Prophet of Allah one day. When he came to the Prophet, he said to the Prophet, and he kept repeating, saying, "Arshidni, O Messenger of Allah, guide me." وَعِنْدَهُ When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam at that particular moment, with him was عُظَمَاءِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ The chiefs and the heads of the people of Quraysh. They were with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He was giving them da'wah. He was speaking to them. And Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum asked. قالت عائشة then said, فَجَعَلَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يُعْرِضُ عَنْهُ The Prophet turned away from him. وَيُقْبِلُ عَلَى الْآخَرِ And he went and faced those who he was talking to. And when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم turned away from Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, the Prophet, he frowned. He frowned his face عليه الصلاة والسلام and he turned away from Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam carried on speaking to those who he was speaking to. And he said to them, أَتَرَى مَا أَقُولُ بَأْسًا Do you guys see any problem with what I'm telling you? So he carried on what he was saying alayhi salatu wasalam. فَيَقُولُ They said to him, no. The Prophet was carrying on his dialogue and Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum was standing there. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent down عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى عَبَسَ The Prophet frowned وَتَوَلَّى And he turned away عليه الصلاة والسلام أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى When the blind man came to him he turned away صلى الله عليه وسلم The Mufassirun The scholars of Tafsir are in unanimous agreement that the one who frowned and the one who turned away is the Prophet. This is ijma', there's no dispute. This verse, the one who frowned and the one who turned away, the scholars of tafsir, the scholars who've done exegesis on this verse, they are all in unanimous agreement, all of them, that the person who turned away and frowned was the Prophet. They are also in consent and in all in agreement that the one who the Prophet frowned to And the one that the Prophet ﷺ turned away from is Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum. This is a consensus. So the one who frowned and turned away is the Prophet. And the one who was turned away from and was frowned at is who? Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum. This is a consensus. Not two scholars of tafsir have differed on this. So this is an ijma'. And I mentioned how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was the one who turned away, based on the hadith of Imam Tirmidhi narrated in his Sunan. Here there's a question. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he referred to Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum as a blind individual. And we know Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ Don't throw at each other nicknames. Don't refer to a person, a deficiency that's in them. You're not allowed to refer to a person with a deficient characteristics that is in them. But we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying in this ayah, أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى When the blind one came to the Prophet. So how do we reconcile between the two verses? The scholars of tafsir, they said, it's very easy. There are two answers. Number one, the first answer is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he described Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum as blind to inform us who are reading the verse that when Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum came and the Prophet was talking to Kufar of Quraysh, this was not out of rudeness. He was blind. He couldn't see. It was a udhur. It's an excuse of fi adami ma'rifatihi, the fact that he wasn't aware of bi inshighali Rasulillah, that the Prophet was busy and talking. Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum was not aware of that. So that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to bring that description. So when you read the verse, you're automatically going to know is due to his blindness, why he wasn't aware that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was talking and he was conversing with a group of people. The second is, if a person is famous with the characteristics, is very well known of him, And it's known that he doesn't have a problem with it. أنه لا يتضاق عليه. It's not a pressure on him to be referred to this. He doesn't mind. He doesn't have a problem with it. And he doesn't mind in the sense where he personally doesn't mind. It's not that you forced him into it. It's not that you gave pressure on him. He genuinely doesn't mind you refer to him in this name. Then this is لا بأس به. There's no harm in this. For you to refer to him as this. And it does not enter the verse وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. ولذلك الإمام البخاري in his صحيح chapter 8 chapter. Bukhari, as you all know, he has an authentic book, right? And Bukhari's صحيح كتاب, his chapterings are basically his understandings. These are his opinions and his views. Bukhari chapter a bab where he called it بَابُ مَا يَجُوزُ مِنْ ذِكْرِ النَّاسِ نَحْوَ قَوْلِهِمْ الطَّوِيلُ وَالْقَصِيرُ. The chapter that it's permissible to say about a person such as the following statement, the tall one, the short one, you're allowed to say. And then Bukhari still carries on his chaptering. وَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And the Prophet said, مَا يَقُولُ ذُو الْيَدَيْنِ. What ذُو الْيَدَيْنِ is saying. ذُو الْيَدَيْنِ was a man who had long hands. And the Prophet referred to him as what? ذُو الْيَدَيْنِ. And this is a story. The Prophet prayed a salah one day. And as he was praying, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he shortened the prayer. And when he shortened the prayer, ذُو الْيَدَيْنِ said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, is the prayer shortened or did you do a mistake? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, none of the two. The salah hasn't been changed, nor did I get it wrong. Then the Prophet turned towards the people and he said, is the matter as ذُو الْيَدَيْنِ saying? Is it as he is saying? Did I get it? Did I shorten the salah? So the Prophet referred to him as what? ذُو الْيَدَيْنِ. Hafiz ibn Hajar, who comments on Sahih al-Bukhari, his explanation of Bukhari, he explained the whole book. He was explaining it for 16 years. Hafiz ibn Hajar, what he did was, he commented on this chaptering. He brought a benefit out. He said, هذه ترجمة معقودة لبيان حكم الألقاب وما لا يعجب الرجل أن يوصف به مما هو فيه وحاصله أن اللقب إن كان مما يعجب الملقب ولا إطراء فيه مما يدخل في نهي الشرع فهو جائز أو مستحب وإن كان مما لا يعجبه فهو حرام أو مكروه إلا إن تعين طريقا إلى التعريف به حيث يشتهر به ولا يتميز عن غيره إلا بذكره ومن ثم أكثر الرواة ذكر الأعمش والأعرج ونحوهما وعارم وغندر وغيرهم والأصل فيه قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Hafiz mentions here that if a person has been given the name and they don't mind them being referred to this, being called tall or being called short, there's no problem. If the person doesn't mind, he's happy with it. It doesn't fall under وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. Also, if you say that description because it's very hard to distinguish him from other people, then you can. You're unable to remember the brother's name. And you say, Akhi, do you remember the black brother? This does not become a racial statement, nor is it a tanabuz bil alqab, or the short one. The brother, the short brother. You're here trying to explain. وَلِذَلِكَ many scholars of hadith, their names are actually deficiency or a characteristics in them. Like the statement al-A'mash and al-A'raj and others. Means their eyes were not straight. Their eyes, the cross-eyed or whatnot, these were descriptions they were given. So they can be identified from other people who were narrators. It was a way to distinguish them from one another. So he says that it's permissible in this situation. And I'm from a community, the Somali community. It's from the norms. To give people nicknames. You rarely come across a Somalian person who hasn't been given a nickname. They always give every single person they see a nickname. They will. It has to be done. They try their hardest not to do it to the females, but I don't know if they succeed in that. But every single person they meet, they try to say something weak in them. So if they see that the person is limping in their walk, they've got a name for him. If the person is short, they've got a name for him. Even if the person is too tall, they still call him short. If the person is very, very tall, they use the opposite. They do that. And you can imagine it's a country, a war-torn country, so people have deficiency, guns hit them, bullets or something. So majority of the times, there's going to be deficiency in one person or another. So there's nicknames that are given. So the person should avoid calling people names that they don't like. If the person has told you they don't like this name, you're not allowed to refer to them at it. I'm going to call them to it. Abasa wa tawalla, the Prophet, he frowned. Wa tawalla, and he turned away. And ja'ahu al-a'ma, when the blind man came to him, alayhi salatu wasalam, the Prophet became busy with a rich kafir, disbeliever. When a person who was blind and weak was present. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ, Allah then says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ, and what would make you perceive, لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَى, that perhaps he might be purified. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's saying to the Prophet, what has given you the knowledge, Muhammad, that this blind man, in which you have frowned at, in his face, that he will purify his sins and his shortcomings by the remember you give him, then who? Then this disbeliever that you're talking to. ولذلك we took in Surah Al-Nazi'at, if you guys remember, that the word yazzakka, wherever you find in the Quran, what did we say it means? Huh? Who said that statement? No. The word we said from the kulliyat al-tafsir, from the comprehensive definition of the tafsir of the Quran, we said that the word yazzakka is what? Is Islam. Who said that? From the Mufassirin, well, I mentioned it. Yeah? Na'am, Ibn Zayd, he said that wherever you find yazzakka, it means Islam. So this verse is going to mean وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ, and what made you perceive that لَعَلَّهُ يَزَكَّى, that he may be, or that he might be, become a Muslim. So it shows that Abdullah ibn Maktum was not a believer before that, based on the commentary of who? Ibn Zayd. That Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum was a disbeliever, he wasn't a believer yet. That if the Prophet spoke to Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum, that he would have listened. And that he would have taken your advice from you. And he would have, how do you know that this one wouldn't have? When you're preoccupied with this one, why don't you think to yourself, Muhammad, Allah is saying, why don't you perceive the idea that this man, Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, may become a believer from your advice, and he may purify himself, and he may turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, than this one you're busying yourself with. And this, inshallah ta'ala, as we're going to see, is as the Arabs say, إِيَّاكَ أَعْنِي وَاسْمَعْ يَا جَارَ. This speech is not being directed at the Prophet, alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam, really. The people who are being spoken to here is who? Us. That we should know that when we're talking to, we're giving da'wah, people generally like to see those who are rich and talk to the rich ones and the wealthy ones and the ones who've got reputation and name and think to themselves that these are the most important ones that da'wah should be given to. When really, no. The followers of the prophets and the messengers are who? Du'afa al-qawm. The weakest of people follow the prophets. As Hiraql al-Azim al-Rum, when Abu Sufyan and him were talking, what did he say? Are the ones who follow him the rich and the wealthy, or are they the poor and the needy ones? Hiraql al-Azim al-Rum, what did he say? The needy and the poor are the ones who follow. And then look what he said to him. Wahum atba'u rusul. And those are the followers of prophets. This is a qa'ida that Hiraql knew. The followers of prophets are generally the weak. We're going to see that soon, inshallah ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that what made you perceive that he's, Abdullah ibn Maktub, might be purified and may take your guidance and your advice. أَوْ يَذَّكَّرَ فَانْتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى, or be reminded and the remembrance will benefit him. That Abdullah ibn Maktub, you give him a reminder, and that remembrance and that reminder that you give him would benefit him. Now, if you look at the verses, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى. عَبَسَ in the Arabic language here is a third party. Allah is not talking to Prophet. He's not saying to him, Muhammad, you frowned your face and you turned away. The scholars, they say, because the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he's reprimanding the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, it is min babi talattuf, it's to be soft, not to talk to him. It's to talk to the people other than him. Are you with me? The lesson is not for him, alayhi salatu wasalam. It's for who? For us. So he wasn't spoken to. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this verse came, of course, he became very sad. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ. And whenever Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum would come, it was narrated that the Prophet ﷺ would always take off his upper garment that he would wear, and he would put it on the ground for Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, and he would say, sit down. The Prophet ﷺ would do that for him. It was narrated. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ. And what would make you perceive that perhaps he might be purified? لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى. أو يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى. Or be reminded, and the remembrance would benefit him. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned two things. He mentioned yazakka and he mentioned yadhakkaru. What is the difference between the two? Yazakka, if we take the call of Ibn Zayd, then it becomes Islam. If we take other than that, yazakka means tasfiyah. It means to purify from yourself any filth or any dirt that's with you. Whether it be shirk, number one. Whether it be bid'ah, which is innovation, number two. And whether it be sins. Those are the three harms that are in humans. Shirk, bid'ah, and sins. You get rid of it. Before you come with the three opposites. At-tawheed, was-sunnah, wa-ta'ah. Tawheed. And then the sunnah. And then the obedience. So before you pour water into a cup, what do you need to do? You need to clean it. That's what the word yazakka means. Yazakka means to clean it first. Yadhakkaru means what? To then pour the water in. Are you with me, brothers? That's one view. The second view of scholars, they say, yazakka means that he's going to fully take your remembrance on board and he's going to be fully purified. That's what yazakka means. And yadhakkaru means that later he doesn't really need a big reminder. Little reminder will benefit him. Allah then says subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَمَّا مَنْ إِسْتَغْنَى فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, أَمَّا مَنْ إِسْتَغْنَى. And as for he who thinks himself without need, he thinks he is not in need. أَمَّا مَنْ إِسْتَغْنَى. The one who believes he's rich and he's sufficed. فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى. To him, you should give attention. The scholars, they said, who was the man istaghna? The one who thought to himself, who believed, who thinks that he is not in need of the iman that the Prophet ﷺ has given. He's rich, he's sufficed from it, he's in no need of it. Who is this person? The Mufassirin, they said, is one of two. The first one is Ubay ibn Khalaf, that he was the one who felt that he was not in need of the Prophet ﷺ's advice. That's one. The second one is Sanadidu Mushriki Quraysh, the heads of Quraysh, who when the Prophet ﷺ sat with them and he tried to give them the advice and he told them to come to Islam, they felt that they're rich, they don't need Iman. And this is a statement that the Kuffar will say to you, what will Islam bring me? What will it do for me? They think to themselves, Darahima Ma'aduda, the little money that they have, the little penny and the little sense that they have, they feel like they're not in need of faith and they're rich from it. Allah is saying to the Prophet, Amma man istaghna, the one who thinks himself without need of the Iman, to him you should give attention. Go to him and speak to him. Tell him that what he has is insignificant. You can have as much money as you want. This Iman, you're in need of it. And without it, you're not going to live a good life. مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً. We're going to give you a good life, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And then Allah says after that, وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَكَّى. And not upon you is any blame if he will not be purified. If after you've given them the advice, and you've given them the reminder, and you've spoken to them, and you've told them to come into Islam, and then you feel that no one is listening to you, they're not taking your advice, Allah says to him, وَمَا عَلَيْكَ. There is no blame on you, Muhammad, أَلَّا يَزَكَّى. That these individuals are not purified, or that they're not taking on board what you have brought forward to them. And this is like the statement of Allah, إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنذِر. Muhammad, you are nothing except a warner. That's your job, just warn them. As Allah said, فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغ. Muhammad, upon you is only to convey the message. Allah also says, لَيْسَ عَلَيْكَ هُدَاهُمْ. Guiding them is not for you. That's not your job. Many people think that when they give da'wah for a couple of years, if the da'wah is not taken on board straight away, they feel like, subhanAllah, I have failed. No, you haven't failed. That's not the job of a da'i. It's not the job of a person who's giving da'wah that results come from your da'wah. You don't necessarily have to have a large followers, large people who follow. You don't have to. That it doesn't show anything. ولذلك, we know that there's going to come a prophet the day of judgment. يأتي نبي وليس معه أحد. There's going to come a prophet and there's no one with him. Is there anyone with him? No one. By himself. He's going to come the day of judgment. No followers. No one took his religion. No one followed him and no one submitted to his deen. Are you with me, brothers? يأتي نبي وليس معه أحد. So we're going to say that prophet didn't do da'wah? Is that what we're going to say? Now what's happened is that many people, because they think da'wah is connected to the number, what they will do is they will run after the number, whatever it may cause the da'wah. Does it make sense? Whatever will bring the crowd. And that's wrong. The religion is what you have to convey. Allah also says in another ayah, لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمُسَيْطِرٍ. Muhammad, you're not one who governs them. One that you can force them and take the religion and put it into their hearts. That's not your job. Your job, Muhammad, is to go out there, to convey the message, to tell them about what Allah said, to tell them what Allah prohibited. And once you convey that, if they take it from you, good. If they don't, you've not done anything wrong. Just follow the legislated way. And as we said before, Fir'aun. Allah knew that Fir'aun would not take Islam. The religion of Musa. Allah knew he wasn't going to take it. And Allah knew that Fir'aun would not submit to the Lord and the only one. But still did he tell him to go to Fir'aun? He did. He said, اِذْهَبْ إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنَ إِنَّهُ طَغَىٰ فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرْ أَوْ يَخْشَىٰ. Go to Fir'aun, speak to him in a soft way, maybe he may turn back from his transgression. But Allah knew that Fir'aun won't come. But Nabiullah Musa was being told, you come with the means, leave the results with me. There are some scholars, if you look at their biographies and you look at their lives, they lived and some of them spent their lives in prison. They were nothing. They were insignificant in their community. No one looked up to them. They were, but when they died, what did they become? A'imma, a'imma. You rarely come across books except they're quoted and they're referenced. Sah? So sometimes you may not see the fruits of your hard work. You may not see it. And it may not happen for you. That doesn't mean that you went wrong and everything went wrong and you didn't do the religion how it was meant to be done. That's why Allah says to the Prophet, وَمَا عَلَيْكَ, there's no blame upon you, Muhammad, أَلَّا يَزَكَّى, if they will not be purified, if they don't take guidance from this. This is nothing upon you. Here I have to mention a powerful benefit, which is, I read from Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi, rahimahullah, and before him, Al-Imam Al-Razi, both of them, they said something. They said that Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, what he did was wrong. Qurtubi, he criticized Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum's action. Al-Razi went even a step further. And he said that Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum كان يستحق التأديب والزجر. He deserved to be mannered and to be told to stop what he was doing. And the reason why he says is because he said Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, even though he was blind, he could what? He could hear. That the Prophet was talking to somebody, he could hear. And people who are blind, he said, their hearings are very strong. So he knew that the Prophet was speaking. And he interrupted the Prophet's speech. And he spoke wrong. So he was faulted and he is correctly faulted. And he is wrong in what he did. This is what Qurtubi said and Al-Razi did. And both of them are wrong to say that. For two reasons. The first one is, Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, the verses in the Surah to Abasa, had actually praised him. Where Allah says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى, the one who came to you striving, وَهُوَ يَخْشَى, and he is in a state of fear. So Allah praised Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum's doings and the way he came to the Prophet. The second is, Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum was blind. And Allah said in the Quran in Surah Al-Fath, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٍ, the blind, there is no harm on him when he does. Because of his blindness, he's excused for it. So he is marfu'un anhu al-haraj. You can't blame him because of his blindness, he's excused. Not to mention that Allah specifically chose to mention that description of his to show you that he was unable and he didn't know. That's very important. Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, who was he? Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum was a noble companion. He has many virtues in the Quran, and he has many virtues in the Sunnah. Let's mention some of it. The first one is what I mentioned. Allah praised him in how he came to the Prophet. Allah said, وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى Muhammad, as for the one who came to you striving, وَهُوَ يَخْشَى And he was in a state of khashya. Khashya means fear مَعَ التَّعْظِيم. Khashya is greater than khawf. Khashya means fear with venerating, glorifying Allah. That's how Abdullah ibn Maktum came. So Allah praised him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also Abdullah ibn Maktum, as an Imam Muslim narrated in Sahih min Hadith Abdullah ibn Umar, that كَانَ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مُؤَذِّنَانِ That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he used to have two individuals who used to do adhan for him. Who were they? Abdullah ibn Maktum and Bilal. Both of these companions, Bilal and Abdullah ibn Maktum, both of them were the callers of adhan. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us the virtue of those two, those who do the adhan, that they're going to come أطول الناس أعناق يوم القيامة. That the people who do the adhan are going to come the day of judgment with the longest neck. And this is a sign of beauty. They're going to come أطول الناس أعناق يوم القيامة. So they're praised. Abdullah ibn Maktum was a mu'addin who used to call the people to the best of actions, which is salah. That's a virtue. For who lakin? The Prophet Ali, who is a mu'addin of the Prophet. Also, Bukhari narrated in his Sahih, من حديث زيد بن ثابت رضي الله تعالى عنه that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم Zayd was sitting with the Prophet and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had his thigh on top of the thigh of Zayd بن ثابت. Are we all together? They were sitting so close that the Prophet placed his thigh on top of the thigh of Zayd بن ثابت. Are we all together, brothers? And as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting, he said to Abdullah Zayd ibn Thabit, write. He was dictating for him an ayah. He said, write this. Zayd got ready and he started to write. He wrote the ayah, لا يستوي القاعدون من المؤمنين والمجاهدين في سبيل الله. Ah, I never read the verse wrong. The ayah came down like that. Allah says, لا يستوي القاعدون They are not the same and they are not equal. The one who sits back from jihad, who does not participate in jihad, he stays at home, he sits back. Al-qa'id is the one who doesn't participate in the battlefield. لا يستوي القاعدون The ones who sit back are not equal to what? والمجاهدون في سبيل الله And those who go out and fight in the cause of Allah, they're not equal. How can they be the same? One is defending the deen and defending the religion with his blood, his wealth and everything. And another one is sitting at home. They're not the same. Abdullah ibn Maktum, when the ayah was being written, by who? Zayd ibn Thabitin. Zayd ibn Thabitin was writing it. Abdullah ibn Maktum, he had come in. When he came in, whilst Zayd ibn Thabitin said, whilst I was writing the verse, he said, Wallahi by Allah, لو أستطيع الجهاد لجاهدت. Oh Messenger of Allah, if I was able to fight in the cause of Allah, I would fight in the deen of Allah. وكان أعمى and he was blind. Abdullah ibn Maktum. In other words, I have something that's preventing me from fighting. I want to be from those who are the mujahid. But here this verse is taking that value away from me due to the fact I'm blind. فأنزل الله على رسوله Allah sent down on the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام a revelation. Zayd ibn Thabit said, the Prophet's thigh was on top of my thigh. And whenever the Prophet revelation would come on him, his body would become very weight heavy, extremely. So the Prophet's thigh pushed down the thigh of Zayd ibn Thabit so much so that Zayd ibn Thabit, he said, I feared that it might fracture my thigh, that the Prophet's thigh may break my thighs into pieces. The way it was pushing me down and it was hurting me. And then the ayah came down on him. Alayhi salatu wasalam, غَيْرَ أُولِ الضَّرَرِ Except those who are blind. And this exception, this response only came down for Abdullah ibn Maktum. Allah responded for him to tell him, those who are blind are an exception of this particular statement. So this is a virtue for Abdullah ibn Maktum. He's a sahabiyun jaleel. Another thing that we need to realize, brothers, is that this concept that many people have today, which is to distinguish between those who are weak and those who are fortunate and rich, and those who are poor and weak, you just push them to the side when you give da'wah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said to the Prophet, and these are evidences that make us value those who are sometimes looked down at. Islam is a religion of who is best. Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. The best amongst you is that one who is pious. He can be from whatever background he wants. He can be from whichever community he wants. He is the best in the eyes of Allah if he comes with what? Piety. Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا تَطْرُدِ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ. Muhammad, do not take away and kick out of your gatherings those who are calling to their Lord in the evening and the afternoon. In every moment of their life, they are spending, begging Allah, supplicating to Him. They are true slaves of Him. Don't push those people away. يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ. They are looking for the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا عَلَيْكَ مِنْ حِسَابِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Their accountability is not upon you, nor is your accountability upon them. وَمَا مِنْ حِسَابِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَتَضْرُضَهُمْ. Muhammad, if you throw those people out of your gatherings and you push them away and you dismiss them and you belittle them, فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. You're going to be from the transgressors. You're going to be from the people who have exceeded their limits. You're going to be from those wrongdoers. وَكَذَلِكَ. Allah then says, and like that, فَتَنَّا بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ. We have trialed some of them over others. What does that mean? It means that the disbelievers, their argument was that we're not going to come into Islam because look at these people. Are we going to stick with these people? We're the rich ones. Allah says, وَكَذَلِكَ. And like that, فَتَنَّا. We trialed those who refused to enter Islam because of the poor people around the Prophet. لِيَقُولُوا. So they say, أَهَؤُلَاءِ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. Are these people the ones who Allah favored over us? Meaning, we're the rich ones. We're the upper class. And you're telling us that the lower class, the weak ones, the poor ones, are blessed by Allah and favored over us who were the wise ones, who always used to place the plan, and that these used to follow our plan. Now Allah has somehow favored them and they're guided, and we're disbelievers and we're the wrongdoers. لَقَدْ مَنَّ لِيَقُولُوا أَهَؤُلَاءِ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ بَيْنِنَا أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ. Doesn't Allah know? بِأَعْلَمَ بِالشَّاكِرِينَ. Those who have gratitude. وَإِذَا جَاءَكَ الَّذِينَ. Allah then says to the Prophet, if they come to you, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِآيَاتِنَا. Those who believe in our verses, if they come to you, فَقُلْ. Say to them, those people, if they come to you, the believers, and they come into Islam, regardless of their background and what they are, if they come to you, فَقُلْ. Say to them, سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Peace be upon you. كَتَبَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَى نَفْسِ الرَّحْمَةِ. Allah has obliged on Himself, and He's made it obligatory on Himself, to bestow upon you His mercy. Now that you've come into Islam, peace be upon you. And Allah has made it upon Himself that He's going to have mercy upon you. أَنَّهُ مَنْ عَمِلَ مِنْكُمْ سُوءًا. Any one of you who has done crimes and has done wrongs before, ثُمَّ تَابَ مِنْ بَعْدِ. And then he repents from it. وَأَصْلَحَ. And then he perfects his situation. فَإِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah is one who is forgiving, and He is one who is merciful. Also Allah says in another ayah, wasbir. Muhammad, be patient. The word sabr in the Arabic language, what does it mean? Habsun nafs. Imprison yourself. Imprison yourself with who? Ma'al ladina, with the ones. Yad'una rabbahum, those who are calling to their Lord. Bil ghadati wal ashiyyi yuriduna wajha. Imprison yourself. Be patient with them. Sit around these ones, these companions who are with you. Bilal and Suhaib al-Rumi and Salman al-Farisi, the likes of these people, not from the upper class. Be patient and restrict yourself and restrain yourself in their gatherings. وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ. Don't turn your face and your eyes away from these individuals. تُرِيدُ زِينَةَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Don't turn away from these ones whilst you're looking at the other ones so you can get glamours and the glitters of this dunya. وَلَا تُطِعْ. And do not obey. مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ. Those whose hearts we have locked and placed on them seals and dhikna in our, of our remembrance. وَاتَّبَعَ. And they have followed هَوَاهُ, their desires. وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. And their matters have become scattered from them. Don't obey those people. A people who have made their Lord their desires. Don't listen to these people. Don't obey a disbeliever who chose to follow his desires, who chose to turn away from the remembrance of Allah. Don't obey these people. Their matters is what? وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. However much it seems that their matters are organized and their matters are together, the truth of the matter is Allah is saying, وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. Their matters are scattered. It's not going to go long. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said about Nabiullah Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Nuh, Surah Hud, there's a long story that happened. Nuh said, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِ. Nuh came to his people. And what did he say to them? إِنِّي لَكُمْ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. I am a clear-cut warner for you guys. أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Don't worship anybody other than Allah. إِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ أَلِيمٍ. I fear for you all a severe punishment. عَذَابَ, a punishment. يَوْمٍ, a day. أَلِيمٌ, that's severe. فَقَالَ الْمَلَأُ الَّذِينَ, the group, Mala' is a group. فَقَالَ الْمَلَأُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, a group of those disbelievers, they said to Nabiullah Nuh, مِنْ قَوْمِ, from his people, مَا نَرَاكَ, we do not see, إِلَّا بَشَرًا مِثْلَنَا, we do not see you except as a human like us. All we know you is as a human like us. You're nothing except a human. وَمَا نَرَاكَ, and we don't perceive you. The only way we see you is تَبَعَكَ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ هُمْ أَرَادِينُنَا بَادِيَ الرَّأِي. The ones who have followed you are the low ranked, pathetic ones have followed you. Insignificant ones are your followers. That's how we look at you. وَمَا نَرَى لَكُمْ, and we do not see for you عَلَيْنَا مِنْ فَضْلٍ, that you have any virtue over us. We don't see that. بَلْ نَظُنُّكُمْ كَاذِبِينَ, we believe you're all liars. These are statements that you hear from people who always say to the ulama, people of knowledge, هكذا. They say this to the prophets, and they say to those who inherited the prophets. They accuse them of what? Of being nothing insignificant to them, تَحْقِيرًا, belittling them. قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ, نَبِي اللَّهِ مِنُوحْ said to him, oh my people, أَرَأَيْتُمْ إِن كُنْتُ عَلَى بَيِّنَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّي. How about if I am on clear proofs, I have proofs of my Lord. I am right and you guys are wrong. If that was the case. وَآتَانِ رَحْمَةً مِنْ عِنْدِي, and Allah has placed for me and He's given me a mercy from Him. I am blessed with by Allah's mercy. What about if the case is like that? فَعُمِّيَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ, and you guys are blinded from the truth. What would the situation be? أَنُلْزِمُكُمُوهَا, should we then burden you into it? وَأَنْتُمْ لَهَا كَارِهُونَ, whilst you guys are averting from it, turning away from it. وَيَا قَوْمِ, my people, لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مَالًا, I am not asking you guys for money. I am not asking you for dinar وَلَا dirham. I don't want money from you guys. إِنْ أَجْرِيَ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ, my reward is only with Allah. وَمَا أَنَا بِطَارِدٍ, and I am not going to kick away. And I'm not going to get rid of الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those who are believers. إِنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ, these are going to meet their Lord in a good way. وَلَكِنِّي, but أَرَاكُمْ, I see you all قَوْمًا تَجْهَلُونَ, a group of people who are excessively ignorant. I'm not going to get rid of these people around me. Because this is what they were saying. If you want us to sit with you, if you want us to listen to you, get rid of these people you're sitting with. We can't sit in a gathering where the people, it just doesn't look nice. We need a good gathering. We're rich, we're up there, we're upper class. Are you going to make us sit with people who were once our slaves? Are you really going to do that? That's what Quraysh was saying. That's what they were saying. وَيَا قَوْمِ, look what the Nabiullah Nuh said. وَيَا قَوْمِ, my people, مَنْ يَنْصُرُنِي مِنَ اللَّهِ, who is going to give me victory from my Lord, إِنْ تَرَتُّهُمْ, if I kick these people off my gathering. Who is going to give me victory? أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ, are you guys not taking these reminders that you've been given? وَلَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ, and I'm not going to say to you guys, عِنْدِي خَزَائِنُ اللَّهِ, that I have the treasures of your Lord, that I have the keys to all your provisions. I'm not saying that to you. وَلَا أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ, and I'm telling you guys now, I do not know the unseen. Nabi Allah say this. وَلَا أَقُولُ, and I'm not going to say to you guys, إِنِّي مَلَكْ, I'm an angel. I'm not saying that. وَلَا أَقُولُ, and I'm not saying to you, لِلَّذِينَ تَزْدَرِي أَعْيُنُكُمْ, those who you are looking down at and you're belittling them, لَنْ يُؤْتِيَهُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا, I'm not going to say to you guys that Allah is not going to give these people good. Of course He would. These people you're belittling, I'm not going to make you guys hear what you want to hear. By saying to you guys, these people, Allah is going to destroy them. I'm just trying to keep them in this circle so they just don't give me a hard time. No. I'm telling you now, these who I'm with, you're looking down at, لَنْ يُؤْتِيَهُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا, I'm not going to say to you, Allah is not going to reward them. Allah will. Allah أَعْلَمُ بِمَا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, Allah knows what's in these people's hearts. إِنِّي إِذَا لَّمِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, and if I kick them out of my gathering and I get rid of them just so I can get you guys, then I am a wrongdoer. I can't. So what you find here is that this concept of the people are upper class, and what do you find generally nowadays? VIP, subhanAllah. Sahih. There's a VIP. This is all against the Nusus al-Wahyain. Are you with me, brothers? VIP is the one who goes to Jannah al-Firdaus. Sah? Even sometimes, what do you find? In the lecture, they say that the last speaker is the best. The lecturers were giving reminder to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, calling the people to the deen, the best to last. They're dividing between the speakers. The people are different. You have the front seat is this much, this is much. In our religion, none of that. ولذلك Allah subhanahu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hiraql al-Azim al-Rum, when he asked Abu Sufyan, he said to him, فَأَشَرَافُ النَّاسِ يَتَّبِعُونَهُ أَمْ ضُعَفَاءُهُ. Who are the followers of Muhammad? Are they the Ashraf, the chiefs and the tribal leaders? Or are they the weak ones? And Abu Sufyan, he responded by saying, بَلْ ضُعَفَاءُهُمْ. Hiraql then said in response, وَهُمْ أَتَبَاعُ الرُّسُلُ. These who you've mentioned are the followers of prophets. The people who follow prophets are people whose hearts are not connected to the dunya. Underline that. Always remember that. They have no attachment to this dunya. Ya ikhwa, if you really want to be a follower of the prophets, you need to be as far and as detached from the dunya as much as you can. The more you're clinging onto the dunya and the more you're into it, the more it eats into your what? Into your following of prophets. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll give you guys a stopping point here, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. I know it's very short today. I just want these surveys to be done. Anything which I have said that was wrong is from me and shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.